this video we'll discuss about appendectomy. This is one of the most important question which can be asked in endodontics or surgery or periodontics. We have to write definition, objectives and rationale, and indications, contraindications, surgical procedure and postoperative care. By definition, it is the surgical amputation or removal of the apex of a tooth root, right? Then coming to the objectives and rationale, there are three objectives or three reasons for performing appendectomy. The first one is curettage, resection and inspection. Curettage is nothing but if there is periapical pathology, you can see in this diagram, if there is periapical pathology like this, if it is small, right, if it is small, once you do the root canal treatment, mostly it will resolve. But when the periapical pathology size is large, or if there is improper root canal treatment, that is percolation of the saliva or fluids, oral cavity fluids into the periradicular region through the apex, that is inadequate filling, root canal filling. In those cases, this periapical pathology may persist and it may continues to grow. In those cases, you have to go for appendectomy, right? In that, we have to completely surgically expose the root end, right? Surgically expose the root end, and we have to completely do this periradicular curettage. That means we have to completely remove the granulation tissue. Then resection. The most common cause of failure of root canal treatment is nothing but inadequate cleaning of apical third of the root, right? If this is the root, then it is divided into the coronal third, middle third and apical third. In apical third, you can find most lateral canals. Due to that, that means in conventional root canal treatment, we may not properly clean those lateral canals. That means infection persists in those lateral canals, apical third of the root. That is the most common cause of failure of root canal treatment. So in those cases, after re-root canal also, we have to, if there is failure, we have to go for resection of the apical third of the root. Appendectomy is nothing but resection of the apical third of the root. That means we will remove this part of the root. That's all. Then inspection. In some cases, to identify the causes of failure, or for biopsy purposes also, we can go for appendectomy. These are the reasons and objectives of appendectomy. Then coming to the indications, you can remember as B, fail, right? B means B for biopsy and E for exploratory surgery. That means this inspection purpose. But this is the less common indication of appendectomy. Then F for failure. Failure of root canal treatment, or failure of re-root canal treatment, or failure of previous surgery, that is previous appendectomy. These are the failure. There are three conditions in failure. Once the non-surgical endodontic treatment, that is root canal leads, fail, at least we should attempt that re-root canal at least twice before going for surgical treatment, that is before going for appendectomy. So failure of root canal treatment, or failure of re-root canal treatment, or failure of previous surgery. In those cases, we'll go for appendectomy. Then A for anatomical problems. That means you may not do cleaning and shaping, very good cleaning and shaping, due to some anatomical problems in that tooth root. There may be calcified canals. You can see the calcified canals or pulp stones, which may obstruct our pathway to the root apex. The main point in cleaning and root shaping is nothing but we have to do it well until the apical constriction or apical foramen. But in the case of calcified canals, you cannot reach until this point, right? In those cases also, we have to go for appendectomy. Or severe root curvature. When there is severe root curvature, our files cannot pass to the apical foramen. In those cases also, we have to go for appendectomy. Then I for iatrogenic causes. That is doctor-induced causes. They are latching or blockage during BMP, biomechanical preparation. If our technique is faulty, if there is technical fault, then it may result in latching or blockage. Right? Latching is nothing but if it this is the root canal, right? This is the root canal. So ledging is nothing but the blockage or formation of blockage here or formation of a ledge here. So our files cannot pass until the foramen, apical foramen. In those cases also you can go for apicectomy. Our instrument separation, right? If there is severe root curvature, instrument may separate in the apical third of the root. If it is separated in the coronal third or middle third, then we can bypass the instrument. Right? That is not the indication for apicectomy. But our area of concentration in apicectomy is nothing but apical third of the root. Right? That means when there is root separation in the apical third, then we can go for apicectomy. That too, the root, that instrument separated is extruding out of the foramen. That is extruding into the periradicular tissues. In those cases, you can go for apicectomy. If it is within the canal, then we can obturate until that point. Right? After overfilling, that means if there is overfilling of the gutta percha, that is over extrusion, extrusion of the gutta percha into the periradicular tissue. In those cases, leading to the foreign body reaction, most of the cases, that is over extruded gutta percha, will not result in any symptoms. But in some patients, it will lead to the foreign body reaction, extremely painful reaction. Right? In those cases, you should go for apicectomy. And root perforation. Again, same. Root perforation in the apical third of the root. If it is in the middle third or coronal third, then you can go for repair with MTR, anything. But if it is within the apical third, then you should go for apicectomy. Right? Then R for root fracture. That too, horizontal apical third root fracture. That means root fractured like this, right? Root fractured like this, that is horizontal fracture. If it is vertical fracture, then you should go for extraction of the tooth, right? Or if this root fracture is in the middle third or coronal third, in that case also you should go for extraction of the tooth. But if it is in the apical third only, then we can retain the tooth and we can go for apicectomy to remove that apical third part. Okay, these are the indications of apicectomy. Remember, B, fail. You can write indications easily. Then coming to the contraindications. When there is active infection, that is when there is active periradicular bone destruction, in those cases contraindicated, it is contraindicated. Right? Or poor periodontal support, that is there is extreme interdental bone loss due to the periapical pathology and the tooth is extremely mobile. If there is grade 3 mobile or grade 2 mobile, in those cases you will go for extraction of the tooth. That is, apicectomy is contraindicated. Or if there is proximity to the vital structures, especially in the mandible, if it is proximity to the inferior alveolar nerve, in those cases apicectomy is contraindicated. Right? Then systemic problems like bleeding disorders, hemophilia, right, or immunocompromised status due to the HIV or anything else. So in those cases also, or if there is any heart problems, right, in those cases also apicectomy is contraindicated. Simple. There are only 4 contraindications for apicectomy. Right? After that, surgical procedure. Generally, this procedure can be comfortably done in local anesthesia. We have to give the block anesthesia. That means if you are operating, if you are doing it on the lateral incisor, right side lateral incisor, upper lateral incisor, then you should go for infraorbital nerve block on the right side, and in the opposite side, in the midline, you can go for infiltration. Right? There are 2 purposes. Anesthesia provides local anesthesia provides anesthesia of that region, and it also provides hemostasis, that is bleeding control. Then soft tissue incision. There are 4 types of incision which can be used for apicectomy. Right? First one is semilunar. You can see in this diagram. So our area of concentration is nothing but upper lateral incisor. Will perform or will do the procedure on lateral incisor, right? So the first incision is nothing but semilunar incision. That means our incision will be like this, right? So this is nothing but semilunar incision. So when the periapical pathology is centered around the root apex, in those cases you can go for semilunar incision, right? In those cases you can go for semilunar incision. That means in this case you can see this. This is the periapical pathology which is centered over the root apex. In those cases you can go for semilunar incision. That is the only indication. But the disadvantage of semilunar incision is that there is limited access and visibility, right? And in some cases it may result in the dehiscence, because our incision line may fall into the bone defect after bony window preparation. Then the second incision type is nothing but sulcular incision. Sulcular incision, then otherwise called as crevicular incision or full thickness flap. In this there are three varieties, right? First one is triangular, that is circular incision with only one releasing incision. I will see this. So in this case always make sure that you involve one side tooth, at least one tooth on either side of the your area of target, right? My area of target here is lateral incisor, so I will involve the interdental papilla of at least one teeth on either side. So this is the circular incision. Circular incision is nothing but incising through the gingival sulcus, right? So depending on your exposure you need, you can go for single releasing incision, right? That means I will take a releasing incision here, then it is called as triangular flap. If you take two releasing incision, then it is called as rectangular flap. That means I will take another incision, right? So in rectangular flap, this vertical releasing incision is somewhat straight, extending into the vestibule, and in trapezoidal flap, this vertical releasing incision is somewhat divergent into the sulcus, right? That means there is broad base like this. This is the apex and this is the base. When there is broad base, you call it as trapezoidal flap, right? Trapezoidal or rectangular or triangular flap. After that, Luke-Oxenbein flap, right? The ideal flap is this one, circular or full thickness flap. Most of the cases will do with this circular flap. We may go for one releasing incision or two releasing incision depending on the need. But the most commonly used one is circular or full thickness flap. When there is crown on the teeth, that is when there is caps, fixed bridges, right? That means say these are the caps, right? These are the caps, fixed bridges. So in those cases, if you take the circular incision, due to the gingival recession postoperatively, there may be black triangles exposed. So that will lead to the aesthetical problem. To avoid that, this design is used. That is Luke-Oxenbein design is used. In this, there are two components. One scalloped horizontal incision and another one is vertical incision, right? That means if I am doing on the this side, left side lateral incisor, so I will place a scalloped horizontal incision in the attached gingiva. Leave at least 2 to 3 mm of attached gingiva from the gingival sulcus, That means I have left here, right? I have left some amount of attached gingiva in this region. Circular means we'll take through the gingival sulcus here. Incision will be here. But in Luke-Oxenbein flap design, we'll leave some amount of tissue. That means this is the amount of tissue left. That is 2 to 3 mm. And in attached gingiva, we'll place a scalloped horizontal incision. And two vertical incision, almost straight, right, like this. Two vertical incisions are joined with this scalloped horizontal incision. The indication of Luke-Oxenbein flap is in case of crowned teeth, when there is presence of crown on the teeth, especially in the anterior region, that too, for aesthetic purpose, right. Then fourth incision type is envelope. Envelope is nothing but incising through the gingival sulcus of the teeth without any releasing incision. This is helpful in the cases of mandibular posterior teeth. If you want to go for apicectomy on the mandibular posterior teeth, then this envelope flap is used. That means incision like this. We will take crevicular incision without any releasing incision. So there are four types of soft tissue incision. The most common used is circular, right? After incision, we have to elevate the flap. That is, full thickness flap is elevated and it is retracted. You can see in this diagram, this is the full thickness circular flap I am using now. So, this red color one is nothing but the flap elevated, right? This is the retracted, this is the upper lip. And this is the approximate root end, right? So, after flap elevation and retraction, you have to locate the root end. This is the most important point in apicectomy. After elevation, we have to locate the root end. When there is the breach or breakage in the cortical plate, then you can easily identify the root end. That is one method. Right? Then when there is axial crackling or already perforation in the cortical plate, you can easily locate the root end. This is one method, right? And second method is, you can go for approximate, that is when the cortical plate is intact, when the cortical plate is intact, we should assume a approximate position of the root end and mark that root end with the gutta percha. That means, I am not seeing here anything, so I am assuming that this is the approximate root end of the lateral incisor. In that place, I will place a gutta percha and will take a IOPA, that is radiograph. On that, you can see that because gutta percha is radio opaque. So, depending on the IOPA, you can locate the root end. This is another method of locating the root end. Or if there is slight axial crackling, in that case, you can take a sharp probe and you can go on probing in that area. So, if there is axial crackling, that is thin cortical plate, obviously with that probe pressure, you will enter into the cavity. So, these are the three methods of locating root end. Once you locate the root end, then you can go for proceed with the bone removal, right? Continuing the surgical procedure flowchart. So, after locating root end, the next step is osteotomy, right? So, this is the micromotor and this blue colored one is nothing but our osteotomy. We have opened a window in the buccal cortical plate, right? Always make sure that when you are cutting the bone, maintain high irrigation. You could use distilled water or you can use normal saline also, right? So, for this heat dissipation, right? That means if there is heat generation, there obviously when you are cutting the bone, there will be the heat generation. To avoid bone necrosis from that heat generated, you should maintain the irrigation, right? That is most important point when you are cutting the bone, right? And in your osteotomy, you should make sure that you will expose at least 3 mm of the root apex, right? In this diagram, you can see here, right? In this diagram, this black colored one is nothing but the root. This blue colored one is nothing but the bone. So this area is the our osteotomy, that is window prepared in the buccal cortical plate. This is the buccal cortical plate, right? And this is the apical third of the root exposed. At least there should be exposure of 3 mm, right? So after preparing adequate osteotomy, you have to do the apical curettas. That means you have to remove the granulation tissue. Most important step for success of apicectomy is nothing but complete removal of the granulation tissue or any lining in that region, right? You can see here, this is the spoon excavator, right? This is the spoon excavator excavating the granulation tissue. This is the granulation tissue. So this cavity will be filled with the granulation tissue. So you have to completely remove that granulation tissue. When you are removing the granulation tissue, you can expect much amount of bleeding because granulation tissue is richly vascularized, right? You have to completely remove the granulation tissue. That is the main step for success of apicectomy. After removing, you can see like this. So next step is root and resection, right? So in this diagram, you can see that we have to remove the apical third of the root. That is at least 3 mm of the root apex should be removed. So if you include 3 mm, that is if you resect 3 mm, then most of the lateral canals are included in that part. That is called as apical delta. Last 3 mm of root apex is nothing but apical delta, which mostly comprises lateral canals or any ramifications in the root canal, right? So when you are cutting the root apex, you have to maintain a 45 degree angle. This is somewhat controversial. Some books will say 10 degree angle, or some books he will give a perpendicular cut only. That means like perpendicular cut or maintaining a 45 degree angle, right? 45 degree angle is nothing but cutting like this. So the advantage of maintaining 45 degree is you can easily have the visibility and accessibility to the root canal. If you are placing perpendicular, that is a straight cut, then you have the difficulty in visualizing the root canal and in preparation of the retrograde preparation of the root canal also. So maintain a 45 degree angle, which is towards the buccal cortical plate like this. So this amount of the root apex will be removed. And after that, after resection, we have to go for retrograde preparation. After resectioning this part, and we will take out this part. And after taking that, after maintaining 45 degree, you can see like this, right? In this diagram, I have resected root apex maintaining 45 degree, and this black colored point is nothing but the root canal, and it is the resected root apex, and this blue colored one is nothing but the bone window prepared in the buccal cortical plate, right? So after resection, you have to go for preparation, right? You can see in this diagram, ultrasonic trips, retrograde, there are specialized instruments for this step, ultrasonic retrograde scalar tips or cutting tips, right? You can see in this diagram, with the help of this, you can prepare a cavity, or you can prepare mostly a class 1 cavity preparation in the root canal, that is approximately for 3 mm. You have to prepare for 3 mm. In this case, this is the filled one, right? You have the this black strips nothing but the guttapercha, that is root canal filling already done, that is obsuration. So you have to take out that at least for a distance of 3 mm like this, right? So after preparation of the retrograde preparation, this is, say this is the retrograde preparation. So in this preparation, you have to go for the retrograde filling. But before going for retrograde filling, irrigate that region, right? And control the hemostasis. Because there should not be mixture or there should not be contamination of your filling material with the moisture or body fluids. For that you have to control the hemostasis. Mostly the bleeding problem will be from the opening of nutrient canals in the or nutrient vessels in the bone. So if there is difficulty in controlling the bleeding, then you can use the epinephrine soaked gauze or local anesthesia, that is vasoconstrictor soaked gauze, right? In this diagram, this red colored one is nothing but the gauze placed in the cavity, our window, at the floor of our window. That will helpful in the hemostasis, right? So after preparing about approximately 3 mm of the root canal via retrograde approach, we have to do the retrograde filling, right? Initially, in older days, they are used to do this retrograde filling with the amalgam. But currently, mineral trioxide, trioxide aggregate, that is MTA, is the recommended material for this retrograde filling. The purpose of retrograde filling is, the purpose of this filling is nothing but avoiding any contact between the root canal and the periradicular tissue. Right? So, in a well obturated root canal also, there are some voids and there will be a percolation, that is seepage of the saliva into the periradicular tissue. So, if you block this apex with your MTA or any cement, then there is no contact between this root canal and periradicular tissue. So, obviously that will result in the success of the apicectomy. So, next step is retrograde filling, right? After retrograde filling, we have to go for closure. Generally, interrupted sutures are used, right? You can see in this diagram, this is our suture lines, right? Our incision lines. So, we'll place sutures along the vertical releasing incisions like this, and we'll place sutures in the intradental papilla also, right? In this diagram, you can see this. These are the labial side interdental papillas. You know, this is the projection of the interdental papilla. This is another projection of the interdental papilla. So, you have to approximate these papillas so that you can correctly place back into your flap, right? So, this is the labial side interdental papillas and these are the lingual side interdental papillas. So, when you are suturing interdental papilla, first you have to pass, this is the needle and this is the suture material. You have to pass through the center of the labial side interdental papilla and you have to take out that needle on the palatal side. After that, we have to turn back by incising or by engaging this lingual side flap, lingual side interdental papilla. And we have to take out this needle again on the buccal side. Where you have to tie a knot. So first we'll engage through the center of the labial side interdental papilla and we'll take out that on the palatal side. We'll reverse it and we'll engage palatal side interdental papilla and take out needle on the buccal side and we have to tie a knot. That is the method of suturing. Again, same here also, right? That is the method of suturing for interdental papillas. Right, mostly non-resorbable silky wrist, 3-0 silky is commonly recommended technique. After 1 week, you have to remove the these sutures. Once you place the suture, apply a gauze on that and advise the patient post-operative instructions. In post-operative instructions, we will advise the patient to apply for ice pack. At least for 2 hours, apply the ice pack. It will largely reduce your post-operative swelling or post-operative inflammation. Because we are cutting the bone, you can expect some amount of swelling. So, to reduce that swelling, we are advising ice pack. And we advise the patient not to lift the upper lip or lower lip where you are doing the surgery. Right? And you have to administer antibiotics and analgesics for at least 3 days post-operatively. And you will advise soft diet initially and not to bite on that operated area. And one more important pointing, you have to under occlude that operated area or the teeth where you are operating to avoid any functional movements or functional pressure force on that tooth. If there is slight mobility, then you can ligate the tooth, that you can splint that tooth with the adjacent strong teeth with the help of ligature wires, or you can use the splints also. Right, this is all about apicectomy. If you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel, and follow me on Instagram and Facebook.